Hello, my name is Kevin Inikowski, and this episode is on cognitive defenses. So let's start with the best example of cognitive dissonance. In the 1950s, a UFO led by Marion Keats proclaimed extraterrestrials, or the Guardians, were sending her messages. She and her followers were going to be saved just before the incoming flood that the Guardians were going to bring upon the Earth on December 21st, 1954. Now, this is going to surprise you a bit, but the flood didn't come. Why, you ask? Well, she proclaimed that she was receiving telepathic messages after the date, and her followers' unflagging faith and her own saved the world from destruction. Thus, as Festinger would argue via his cognitive dissonance theory, in order to make up for this internal conflict that they didn't die, they preferentially sought information to support and make consistent their beliefs, i.e. confirmation bias, confirming their beliefs from the excuse that they saved the world, a prime example of cognitive dissonance theory. There may be other forces at work here, though. For instance, the amplification hypothesis implies that the certainty that Marion used with her followers acted to amplify their attitudes of their beliefs. So her undying certainty amplified beliefs via the amplification hypothesis. Most followers may have also had a belief perseverance, or continuing to believe the UFO theory even though obvious evidence suggests it was wrong, like they all didn't die. This is belief perseverance. Let's say many of the followers, after the world was not found to end, internally started to disband the UFO theory like any sane person would. If Marion had gone to them and stated that the Guardians are very powerful and they should keep up their bidding, the followers might be inclined to acquiesce, meaning to accept without protest, due to the acquiescence effect, which states that we wish to appear in a positive light to those of greater authority like Marion Keach. So we accept the beliefs without an argument. Now let's say the cult followers also took up hostages, destroyed property, and hurt people. This would likely have forced them to use some techniques of neutralization, which are pretty self-explanatory. So let's just hit a few. They might argue denial of responsibility, thus saying they had no choice. Marion made me do it. They might argue denial of injury. Person wasn't actually harmed. As you can see, 4 days of starvation didn't actually kill them. Or maybe denial of victim, and that the victim deserved it. They hadn't listened to the UFOs impeding doom. They deserved to die. These cognitive dissonances provide support for what is called functional attitudes theory. It falls under the idea that we have attitudes not because they're correct, but because they're useful to us. That's the function of the functional attitudes theory. Now let's discuss some of Freud's high-yield ego defense mechanisms. First, we have denial. We all do it, like the ostrich effect. We imagine the problem isn't there or that something didn't happen. Like an ostrich, we stick our head into the ground. Next, repression, which involves repressing a painful memory, possibly via a screen memory. Repression is different than regression, which regression is regressing to an earlier stage of life, such as crying or stomping the ground really hard. Reaction formation, another defense mechanism, involves a person acting completely opposite of their emotion, such as a warm greeting to your enemy or laughing at a funeral. Displacement, contrasted to projection, involves transferring your emotions to another object or person, such as throwing your gerbil out the window because of problems pleasing your boss. Now, this is similar to the frustration-aggression hypothesis, which states that any failure to reach a desired goal results in aggression, like throwing your gerbil out the window, or not getting laid, some would say is equally aggravating. Projection, back to the difference between displacement, is putting your feelings you hold onto another person you hold them against. Instead of saying, "I hate my boss," you say, "My boss hates me." Sublimation, the most constructive defense mechanism, is channeling your issues into something constructive. Let's say, preparing for the MCAT by listening to me. Hopefully you find it constructive, but that's up to you. Rationalization, like with the UFO cult, involves rationalizing the issue you're facing, such as saying, "Oh, I just, you know, got some messages that said our unflagging faith ended up saving us all." Rationalization is self-explanatory. Or one can attempt undoing, which is trying to fix your mistake, you know, the right thing to do, undo what you did. Acting out is another defense mechanism which involves having the id, desire, greatly express itself. Acting out is a form of regression, but to an extreme. An interesting defense mechanism is splitting, which involves rationalizing everything into terms of one or the other, right or wrong, splitting them into good or bad. Now, please note there are many other defense mechanisms that are lower yield, such as compartmentalization, compensation, etc., which we're not going to discuss here. So, what causes these issues? Well, we have a tendency to relate the problems that we face to the most immediate cause. Like, for instance, why did we fail our exam? Well, because our teacher gave us a failing grade. Then that makes us think because our teacher hates us. But this is the proximate cause or proximate causation, the most immediate thing. But the real reason that we didn't do well on that exam was because we didn't study sufficiently. The real reason or ultimate cause is also called the distal cause. There were a lot of terms that we just mentioned, but all of them are pretty straightforward, and if they're not, you have to take the time to study them. This brings us to emotion-related biases. Although emotions are deeply discussed in the emotions episode, let's begin with Vex Cognitive Triad, which is a reciprocal cycle of cognitive bias, or cognitive distortion, as Beck calls it. The cognitive distortion is when we focus on the negative aspects of a situation, a type of irrational thought that I'm pretty sure we all do at times. This triad may start with the self, the environment, or even the future. For instance, starting with the self, oh, I suck at life. Then to the environment, this exam is too hard. And then to the future, that means I won't be a future doctor. I can't believe the world gets our hopes up and tears us down. It's so unfair. And boom, irrational thoughts and cognitive distortion in Beck's cognitive triad, all right there. Now, on the opposite end of the spectrum, we have the optimism bias, which just as it sounds, is our belief that things are going to turn out better than they actually will. Sometimes optimism bias is called the valence effect. Why? Because valence is positive or negative emotional charge. But in valence effect, like the optimism bias, we are generally positive. The optimism bias may also end up resulting in a planning fallacy, which is underestimating the time it takes to accomplish a task, such as many students underestimating the amount of time that you have to study for the MCAT. And that's it for this episode.